taught us all that is has bestowed upon us. Today we bring you a message of gratitude and praise through music, dance, readings, ritual, and a powerful spiritual message from our very own Grace, Reverend Dr. Grace Telesco, with her sermon, Finding the Lost Ark, the Mysticism and Significance of the Ark of the Covenant. We are thankful that you could all join us here today. As the great Sufi poet Jalaluddin Rumi reminds us, thankfulness brings you to the place where the beloved lives. We now invite you to come with us into that place of devotion, that space of thankfulness, and that space of gratitude. Please join me in prayer. Remember the name of thy Lord, and devote thyself with a complete devotion. Lord of the East and the West, there is no God save him. So choose thou him alone for the disposer of thy affairs, Al-Quran. We invite you to center now in prayer as we play this chant called There Is No God But God, which is a part of the Islamic article of faith.
There is no God.
Divine laws, without complaining, firmly established in faith, are released from karma.
Those who violate these laws, criticizing and complaining, are utterly deluded and are the cause of their own suffering.
Virtues that are endless and limitless, they are born of the law of righteousness. They dwell in the law, are fashioned by the law.
They have the law as their master, the law as their light, the law as their field of action, the law as their refuge.
Indeed. Let us realize and work with this sound knowledge and perfect faith, that as high as we shall make our mark in mind and spirit,
so high shall be its outward manifestation in our material world. When we learn to trust the universe, we shall be happy, prosperous, and well.
We now understand and follow the spiritual principles that drive us. We claim the tools of divination that guide us.
And we have the manna reminding us to be grateful, and that the one power will always meet all our needs.
Namaste. So how wonderful, it is to be together. And the most important people in the whole world are here, sitting here, in front of us, in front of me, with the exception of my consort, my partner Chris, who is in Florida, but she's gonna watch this. Hopefully that's videotaping. You know, it's been on my heart for a while to talk about this Ark of the Covenant, this message and the meaning that it has for us. How many of you are familiar with the Ark of the Covenant? Heard about it from the Old Testament, at least seen the movie, Raiders of the Lost Ark, right? I thought I would provide some first theological and historical perspective on this mystery, and then share with you my thoughts on the mysticism and significance of this for our spiritual journey. Judaism, as a general rule, rejects physical manifestations of spirituality, preferring instead to focus on actions and beliefs, so that the worship of graven images is harshly condemned throughout the Torah. But early in the history of the Jewish people, there was this one exception to the rule, this one man-made object that was considered intrinsically holy. The origin of the Ark... Okay. We'll be back. The origin of the Ark goes back to Moses at Sinai. And the Ark of the Covenant constructed during the Israelites' wanderings in the desert at the direction and specification of God, was used all the way up until the destruction of the first temple and was the most important symbol of the Jewish faith. Now, spiritually, the ark was the manifestation of God's physical presence on earth, Shekhinah. Did I do that correctly? The Ark of the Covenant contained these three items of extreme significance to the Israelites. The first were two stone tablets bearing the divine inscription of the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments formed the foundation of God's covenant with Israel, commonly referred to as the Law. And this we find in Exodus 31. The second item in the Ark was the rod of Aaron. Now, P.S. back at the ranch, let me just go off script here for a minute. There are two different interpretations, so that there's two different indications of this in the Old Testament and in the Torah. One talks about the only thing that was in the ark were the Ten Commandments. But there's another interpretation that talks about that there were these three items, the Ten Commandments, the rod of Aaron, and the manna. So that's the one that I'm going to talk about. Now the rod, you know, the rod of Aaron was used to part the sea, the Red Sea, and it was also in the film The Ten Commandments. Did everybody see that? Okay, Charlton Heston plays Moses, right? And he goes into Pharaoh and he throws the rod down on the ground and turns into a snake. That's the rod of Aaron. The last item was a golden pot of manna. And the manna was the starchy food that God had miraculously provided for the Israelites during their 40 years of desert wanderings. We see that in Exodus 16. The Ark of the Covenant was where God manifested his presence on earth. The Ark went ahead of the Israelites wherever they traveled. So not only was it the center of worship when it resided in the tabernacle, but the Ark also protected the Israelites in battle. So it had this like supernatural quality to it, right? And it defeated any adversaries that came before them. We hear about this in Joshua. The Israelites also went to the ark to seek any kind of guidance and wisdom for the nation. And that we see in Numbers and in Exodus. In the traveling formation of the desert, the ark was carried about 2,000 cubits ahead of the nation by the priests. When the Israelites went to war in the desert and during the conquering of Canaan, the ark accompanied them. And the ark helped them to remove obstacles and gave them courage and strength. So there was like great mysterious powers that were associated with the ark. And those who transported it could supposedly be lifted into the air. And some, even who touched the ark, died immediately. So, I know. And that's probably where they got all this information from for the Raiders of the Lost Ark movie, right? Now the Jews carried the Ark of the Covenant during their 40 years of wandering. And when they finally settled in Canaan, King David took it to Jerusalem. He was so excited to see the Ark because of what the Ark signified that he danced in his underwear. Much to the dismay of his wife. And I thought, wow, like when would be an occasion where you're actually out in the street in your underwear? A, if your house was on fire, or I suppose, B, if you were so overwhelmed with joy at the presence of God. Now, what struck me most about this whole entire story about the ark was what was inside of the ark. So I want to talk about these three items and what they mean for us, not historically, not theologically, but significantly for today, symbolically for our lives today. The mysticism behind the lost ark, because you know the ark is currently missing, it's lost. But I believe, and I would like to inspire us to think about how we can have these three items in our ark. So the first is the Ten Commandments, the spiritual principles that guided the people. And I'm getting a lot of this from a really wonderful book that we're all familiar with, us, the seminarians, the people who are our worship team and also our seminarian here, is familiar with a book by the name of The Ten Challenges, Leonard Felder. So I'd like to talk about the spiritual principles behind the Ten Commandments for a minute. Number one, I am the one who is and will always be your God. You heard that earlier in the chant, there is no God but God. And this God, this one, this power, helped you in the past and cares about you unconditionally. So from that I gather this spiritual principle of hope. It's like, isn't that so amazing? Like, that we can know that we've got that in our lives? Two, second commandment or challenge or principle, breaking free of things that no longer serve you. In the Hindu tradition, one of the aspects of God or Brahman is Shiva, the destroyer. And so I often pray to Shiva for courage, because I have, there's many things that no longer serve me that I want to get rid of in my life. Impatience, judgment, irritability, control. The second commandment really talks about false idols, but those are the things that no longer serve us, that we want to ask for courage and strength to release them. The third is honor the divine in all things. You know, we talk about, literally, the third commandment is about don't take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, but we understand that if everything is God, that we should be blessing everything, not cursing everything, or not cursing anything, for that matter. Four, be good to yourself. So hey, the spiritual principle behind that, compassion. Honor the ancestors, respect. Lift each other up in spirit, service. Be faithful, integrity. Be honest. Be kind and loving in thought, word, and deed. And the 10th commandment, recognizing our oneness. Because if we recognize our oneness, then there's no jealousy or envy. Because when you get something great, I've actually achieved that as well. Because there's no separation between us. Being in recovery, I think about some of the spiritual principles of recovery also in the 12 steps, you know, honesty and integrity, hope and faith, courage, willingness, humanity, humility, love and service, goodwill. It's all the same stuff. The spiritual principles are the spiritual principles. Whether you adhere to the 10 commandments, the 10 challenges, recovery principles, whatever those spiritual principles are in your life, if you can put them ahead of you wherever you go, like the Israelites did, like a GPS, like a divine GPS system, putting our spiritual principles ahead of all personalities, ahead of all things. So these principles go before us. And the Hindu scriptures, the Bhagavad Gita, those who live in accordance with the divine law without complaining, firmly established in faith, are released from karma. Those who violate these laws, criticizing and complaining, are utterly deluded. We heard that in the call and response. And also the Buddhist sutras were in your call and response. The Israelites were the perfect example of what we are like. We get all of these gifts from the divine, from the one power, and then the minute that something goes wrong, we forgot. We have like built-in forgetters. The Israelites are human, and they're human nature. They're just an indication of human nature. And that's what we do. We forget. And so we criticize and we complain. But we're utterly deluded. We're utterly deluded because we're the cause of our own suffering. So if you have that spiritual principle that all will be well and that everything is God, then even the bad stuff. The second item that went in the ark was the rod of Aaron. Now, Aaron was the spokesperson for Moses. When God spoke to Moses and inspired Moses, Moses was like, not me, why? Well, I have a learning disability. He said, I can't, I don't know if I can speak. Afraid, I'm not a good public speaker, I can't. So he relied a lot on Aaron. Aaron was sort of his consigliere, you know, it was his brother, and it was his spokesperson. And so it's not surprising that he used Aaron's rod to lean on and use as a divination tool. So what's our rod? What rods do we have? What divination tools do we have? Maybe some of us, we're talking about it on the way here in the car. Meditation is a way to invoke the divine. Japa, prayer. And japa is just in Hindu as well as in Buddhist, as well as in Islam, the prayer beads. Using prayer beads and praying, using that energy. Satsanga, good association. is a divination tool, a way in which to invoke the divine. Reiki, healing, card readings, channeling, fire circles, totems, spirit guides, incense, the chime, a way to invoke the divine. So what's your divination tool? What's your spiritual principles? And the third, manna, the bread from heaven, the divine plan that all will be well. Jesus talks about it as, you know, why are you worried? Stop worrying. Why are you worried, he said. We're worried about every little thing. What you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, where you're going to go, where you're going to live. Stop worrying. We got it. I heard somebody the other day, where were we when we heard this? Somebody said, God knows your mortgage. God knows your mortgage. It's like, look at the flowers, look at the birds, look at nature. All will be well. And the same thing happened to the Israelites. See, the Israelites are just like us. We need reminders. We need reminders because we forget. We go right into worry mode the minute that something doesn't go our way. And as we read in Exodus, it was the manna from heaven that fed the Israelites throughout their journey. So here's what they did. I think this is awesome. It was like their little mini gratitude list. Like, what they did was they took the manna and they put it in the ark so that they would never forget that all will be well. A reminder of their gratitude and faith that God would provide. But we're still worried, aren't we? Even though we're reminded by the saints and sages to surrender to the one power and that all will be well, we still worry. So we need to remind ourselves in our daily gratitude of the manna that we've been given and that all will be well. I've been doing this lately. I wake up in the morning and the first thing I do is I go through 10 things, the 10 things that I am most grateful for. And not just like a litany, not just like a list, but I say what it is and why I'm grateful for it. So I start with my life, and then I say why I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for my health and why. I'm grateful for my recovery and why. I'm grateful for my spouse and why. I'm grateful for my family and why. And then I say after the 10 things, and I really have it seed and plant within me, within my ark, the manna, I say thank you, thank you. Thank you. It's such a cool thing. I've been doing it now for a whole month so that I can really make it a habit. Now, in 586 BCE, the Babylonian emperor Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the Temple of Jerusalem, and from that point on, the location of the Ark is unknown. So I'd like to ask us, how do we find the lost Ark in our own individual spiritual journey as we wander through the desert? What are our spiritual principles that we place before us? What is our divination tool? What is our rod of Aaron? And what is our manna? What's inside of our ark? What helps us to remember and invoke the God presence, the God force? What tools do we use to call upon this divine in our life? Whether it be the japa that we do, the prayers, the manna that we have, whatever the divination tool, whatever our principles are, I think it's important that we have that. I know for me, I need that day to day. The ark's not lost. It's within us. So many faith practices and cultures have used the sharing of a meal as an outward manifestation of love and gratitude. And maybe Reverend Farida is going to offer this bread as I'm making this statement. We're going to hold the sacred space and we're going to play a song. It's known as prasad to the Hindu, seda to the Jew, communion in Christianity. In Islam, it provides barakat throughout the year, and a giveaway ceremony to the indigenous. It holds vast meaning and welcomes the stranger. It offers unconditional love for our friends, and it is the acknowledgement that we are all connected, one bread, one body of people, one life force that runs through us. In this spirit of love and gratitude, we invite you to partake of a manna ritual. The bread is a symbol of the nourishment that this spiritual place provides, and this one loaf, while broken into separate pieces, joins us back together as one body of people who are divine. This bread also represents our understanding of the manna from heaven, and that we will always be taken care of, that all we need is provided for us, that this bread represents all of the gifts that we have been given, and that as we take this bread, I invite us to be mindful of the gratitude that we have for all the gifts that we've been given, and not to forget the goodness and blessings of the one source. As we pass the plate of bread around the circle, we invite you to take it, hold it in your right hand, and recognize that we are joined together and connected through the one source, that everything we need is provided for. And then we invite you to listen to the words of the song, All Good Gifts. Grateful, I'm sorry. Absolutely.
I am light. Oh, I hope no more, a dream of more, but giving thanks for what I've got makes me so much happier than keeping scores in a world that can bring pain. I will still take each chance, for I believe that when I will learn to wait, our feet can be learned to dance whenever storm like this.
And now in that same spirit of gratitude and thanks for all of the gifts that have been bestowed upon us, we here at Interfaith Community International, NYC, ask you to be an example of giving. Maharishi Valmiki described the meaning of giving as such. There are three kinds of giving: grudge giving, duty giving, and thanksgiving. Grudge giving says, I have to. Duty giving says, I ought to. Thanksgiving says, I want to. Grudge giving comes from constraint. Duty giving from a sense of obligation. And thanksgiving comes from a full heart. As the offering basket comes around, we ask you to give freely, willingly, joyfully, gratefully, and without expectation. The monetary gift you give today, or the symbolic gift of love and blessings, will go towards assisting the ICI NYC worship team in bringing interfaith worship to our congregants' lives to deepen their spirits, whatever the faith tradition they may espouse. We thank you for your generous gifts and bless you. Namaste.
And scattered the seed on the land. Then you spread and water by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, and so oft refreshing rain. Thank you.
time and the harvest, our life, our health, our food. No gifts have we to offer for all thy loving hearts. But that which thou desirest, our humble, thankful hearts.
Forward and materializes as the scholarship funds, as the opportunities for those who are going to participate in the shift on this planet. And we know that this good work is supported by this offering today. We give great thanks for this. Allow the feeling tone of gratitude and thanksgiving to circulate freely. And so it is.
So it is. Say that the service already has been incredibly powerful, and I'm hoping everyone is feeling like this amazing energy that we've raised already in this room, and for that I'm very grateful. I'm grateful for my path. I'm a student currently in the ISIS International Seminary Bridge Faith Studies program, and I'm due to be ordained in just a few weeks, July 1st, and so I'm really happy to be asked to be a part of this, and I'm so happy to be able to receive the gift of Reverend Grace's sermon today. So the reading that I'm reading is about gratitude, so it's very fitting with my mood in this moment. My gratitude flames. Thorns die, roses live. Hate dies, love lives. Desire dies, aspiration lives. The human in me dies. The divine in me lives. My gratitude flames in the heart of God, never shall die. Eternally they breathe. Eternally they sport. Eternally they manifest the supreme, my supreme. Gratitude. In the life of aspiration and dedication, the gratitude, dear, always runs the fastest, always achieves the most, always becomes the perfection, satisfaction of the highest and most fulfilling and fulfilled supreme in us. Gratitude is not a human achievement. Gratitude is a divine treasure granted to us by the inner pilot within us, the absolute supreme.
So remember when I said about David dancing in his underwear? Our dear Reverend Sala is not going to dance in her underwear. us, and she's going to offer a sacred dance, to offer this as a prayer from all of us, rejoicing, rejoicing, rejoicing for the divine presence as we listen to the song and honor the sacred dance.
I see that some people are probably thinking of taking pictures, but I intend to ask you all to participate with me.
Okay.
And allow this to be a bit of a moving mantra.
Yes.
If you will.
Yes.
There are the words in this song, the chorus of this beautiful song that Grace chose, are when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. I will pray like David prayed. As Grace will pray. And so, just for the moving mantra, if you all will come to your feet for the song, because when it begins, you won't be able to be still, especially with the energy that's generated in this room today. You won't want to be still anyway. But for the very simple, when the Spirit of the Lord, for those who are able and willing, if we can just allow that to move in a circle when we hear when the Spirit of the Lord, and then comes upon my heart, just our arms up to the sky, and then down to the heart, comes upon my heart. And then your dance, whatever that may be at the moment, I will dance like David danced.
Okay?
And just stay to your feet and allow it to move with you, and I'll guide you.
Okay?
That's right, that's right! Put those hands together all over the place! We come to praise and we come to praise and we lift it up! Because he's worthy to be good. I see you, brother. I see you, brother. I see you, brother. I see you, brother.
When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon
I'm away.
It went out.
No, it's okay. Just
hold that right there.
So, I'm not in my underwear, but I don't have my shoes on. I don't have my glasses. I'm off a cunt. So the Spirit of the Lord definitely came upon our hearts. And I always love the Spirit. Spirit descends upon me when I start crying. And so, as we close this beautiful sacred celebration, again, I want to say thank you and gratitude to those of you who are supporting us and love us and came out to be with us in this sacred celebration. And thank my fellow worship team members who I adore and love, Reverend Farida, Reverend Sally, and soon to be Reverend Katie. So join with me in this closing prayer. Great Spirit, one source, all that is. You who are as expansive as the cosmos and as personal as our heartbeat. You who permeate everything that we see and smell and taste and touch and know. We ask for your continued blessings and divine grace to flow through us and around us, protecting us, healing us, filling us with your love and your peace. We know that you are all-powerful, all-knowing, and ever-present Spirit, and that everything in our lives is unfolding exactly as it should, according to your divine plan. We are so grateful for all of the spiritual and material abundance that you have gifted us with. We ask for the understanding to know our higher selves, the true I am in each of us, that which is divine and that which is you. We know that we walk with the Ark of the Covenant. We understand and follow the spiritual principles that drive us. We claim the tools of divination that guide us. And we have the manna from heaven reminding us to be grateful and that the one power will always provide us with all of our needs. And together we say the words that have been spoken throughout the ages from all different paths. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Aho.
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 Ashe.
Ashe.
Blessed be.
Blessed be.
And so it is.
So it
Om
is.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Let's have another round of that song. Let's have another round of that song. Blessings.